place, 10,000 euros. Never really got to do much, Peter Murphy, on this final table. Drawing dead by the turn, but they'll still be proud of him. 15,000 euros will be a small consolation.
Yeah, he's a bit unlucky there, David Curtis. I thought he played a good game today. He picked his moments quite well until that one where he just ran into a big hand.
Welcome to the final table of the Party Poker Irish Poker Championship here from the Radisson Hotel in Galway. Well, only a few players remain. Let's go straight over to our commentator now, Jesse May, as the action heats up.
The situation, of course, David Poole, it looks like he has a lot of chips. He doesn't. He's got basically less than a third of anyone else at the table. The prize jump now from fourth to third, sort of significant enough that, I mean, a guy like Dowling, you know, you got to sit there and think, I could just fold those, actually.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? First of all, David Poole likes to keep all the small denomination chips. He's got those pink ones that are worth 500 each. The yellow ones are 1,000. I think he's only got one of the 5,000 chips in front of him. So it looks like he's got a lot more chips than he is. He kind of does that for psychological reasons, I think. But
Neil, difference between six-handed and four-handed play here? I mean, you got to open a lot more, or?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, every time you lose a player, the chances are, if you've got a decent hand, like an ace in your hand, or maybe a pair in your hand, or maybe a king with a high kicker, the chances are that that's going to be the best hand out of the four. And all the players are aware of that, and that means they can open with slightly weaker hands. Ben Vincent, it's hard for him to open with any weaker hands. I guess he can start opening if he only gets dealt one card now.
And, I mean, Neil, the reason I was asking about folding those threes is the difference between fourth and third, 25,000 euros. And, you know, Ben Vincent knows that, and knows that Dowling knows that. And this re-raise, I mean, it's even hard to call with the ace-queen right now for Dowling, isn't it?
This is an interesting spot, Jesse, for sure. I mean, first of all, Ben Vincent is very well aware of the fact that the prize money for fourth place is 30,000, the prize money for first place is 160,000. He's also aware he's a professional poker player and he's a young kid with a bit of fire in his belly, and he doesn't much care in some ways whether he comes fourth or first. He's going to gamble and try and come first, but if he comes fourth, it's not going to ruin his life. He's up against a guy, Chris Dowling. Chris Dowling's not been in this situation too many times. He doesn't play poker for a living. He may be under some pressure here. He's a family guy. He goes off and does a regular job. And Ben wants to exploit that fact. He's also very aware of the fact that now they've dropped down to four-handed. Chris Dowling, David Curtis, and Rory Brennan. David Poole, Rory Brennan and Chris Dowling can be raising him with a lot worse hands than they were before. And therefore, it doesn't really matter what his two cards are. He just has to say, I know this guy's hand is less than it used to be 20 minutes ago, so I'm going to start pushing him around.
And who could blame Dowling for folding this? I mean, actually, you know, pair of threes is nothing to the re-raise.
Well, of course, the interesting question then is that Chris Dowling's not a total idiot. He's a smart guy. He's going to know that Ben Vincent's been playing all kinds of hands. He's turning over a load of rubbish half the time. And he could think to himself, do you know what? I could push him back off of it with a big re-raise all in. There's wheels within wheels going on in this hand, Jesse.
And it worked last time, didn't it? Last time this exact situation came up, Dowling did push and Vincent did fold.
Well, yeah, but last time, Jesse, Chris Dowling was sitting there with the old ace-queen, one of the stronger hands in poker. A pair of threes just doesn't feel like a great hand. Maybe if it was a pair of sixes, a pair of sevens, a pair of eights, he'd find the courage to do it. But it's hard to do it with that pair of threes.
Exploiting situations, seizing opportunities. I mean, that's what Vincent has been about. And he don't stop. Dowling, Neil, I mean, you'd be crazy if you didn't look over at David Poole and say, this guy has only got 10 big blinds. Let's knock him out, and then I'll go for it. You'd be crazy if you didn't think like that.
Yeah, I mean, that must be a factor in his thinking. He's looking down and thinking to himself, 30 grand for coming fourth. It's an extra 25 grand if I come third, as a minimum. Maybe I could just wait until this David pulls out. I don't need to do anything stupid. I'm going to get myself in a situation where I win a minimum of 55 grand. I don't blame him for thinking like that. But Ben Vincent's certainly going to try and exploit any thinking that's going on that level.
All in.
And Ben Vincent actually has a much bigger hand than he needs to have here. Poole has moved with the queen eight suited. Can't really blame him here.
Yeah, no, I think David Poole's sitting there thinking to himself, if that Ben Vincent, the cheeky little tyke, starts raising my blind again, anything half decent, I'm going to stick the whole lot in. Ben Vincent must know that that was coming. Ben Vincent has got a great sense of what's coming up, and he can feel that the other players are maybe getting a bit hacked off with him raising all the time. He sits there, he looks at ace nine suited, well above the normal kind of rubbish he raises with on the button, and he's thinking to himself, I'm probably going to have to call. I put chips into the pot, the fella's raised me, it's not that much more money, and I'm getting some odds. Ace nine matches up quite well against a lot of hands.
And it's trouble for David Poole, but at the same time, the reason, as you were saying earlier, he didn't do it with an ace rag because he's likely to have two live cards. That's exactly what he's got.
Yeah, and look at the percentages. He's not in such a bad spot. It's about 60-40. It's a massive pot for the direction of the tournament.
All in from Poole. I see a nine. And there's hearts.
Yeah, this is an enormous flop, isn't it? If they didn't manage to get it in before the flop, they'd certainly get it in after the flop. It's about 50-50 now. As you can see, Ben Vincent just a small favorite.
It was red, but it wasn't the heart. Has to be a queen or a heart now. And it looked a bit like a straightening card, but it wasn't. David Poole from the UK out in fourth, Neil.
Yeah, David Poole, he came to the final, played a very patient game, I thought. Made a couple of unusual decisions, a couple of limps where I might have raised. He definitely had a game plan, though, and he had a tricky old day, didn't he, clashing with Ben Vincent in the blinds here and there. And if he'd have won that one, he'd have been right back into it. It was only 60-40. He played very well, I thought.
What does Mike Sexton think down there, Mike?
Well, one Englishman takes out another, and right now, I'm thinking Ben Vincent's thinking, call me butter, I'm on a roll. The guy's winning pot after pot right now. He is the guy that has momentum on his side at the moment.
He certainly is, Mike. And now that we're three-handed, you know, Vincent and Brennan, they've kind of been avoiding each other. But you can't really avoid each other anymore, can you?
Well, you can't, but don't count the electrician out either. He's still got plenty of chips left. So it's going to be a fun and exciting finish here, no doubt about it.
Is, and I mean, it's been great stuff for Chris Dowling. He, as you were saying, Neil, he's an amateur, he's not a pro. This guy has held his head high and been cool.
Yeah, absolutely, his demeanor there is a man with confidence, but now he looks at the leaderboard and he finds that he's there in third. He's the man with a target on his head.
Yeah, I was, I think, shy, stuck on the table. The bottom raised, and I just felt it was time to make a move. Two half decent cards, took my chances. The flop was pretty good, and then that was it, all over.
Dowling on the button right now, and six five suited. Definitely a raise from Vincent. Definitely, I think it a raise from Rory. What about Dowling? What about?
I think Chris Dowling will raise here. He knows the value of the hands three-handed. 6-5 is a deceptive hand. If you get involved in a big pot, you're likely to have two live cards. And, you know, he has to raise occasionally. He's got the button. I don't see anything wrong with this move at all, and I think it'll probably get through.
And Rory Brennan's problem, obviously, he's done a lot of good things lately. But he keeps getting he's getting re-raised. Just feeling like he can't really afford right now to make a move and have to pass again.
Absolutely,
right?
Jesse. There's another great example there where Rory Brennan looked at the queen nine, thought to himself, this is well above the range of this guy's raising hands. It's the kind of thing I would like to have on the button and raise with, but he's already done it. I just have to throw my hand away knowing that he's probably just bluffed me.
Cool.
And it's just something, it's a new page here.
Yeah, this is a weird situation, and this is a slightly dangerous flop here. Obviously, both players have a six in their hand, a six come on the flop. Ben Vincent deciding to play with a weak hand out of position against Chris Dowling, probably because he feels that playing flops against Chris Dowling is going to be a more profitable situation than playing flops against Rory Brennan. He can't help it, the fact that he's sitting on Chris Dowling's right, so he has to play flops out of position against him quite often.
Is there any chance that maybe Vincent is just feeling a bit overconfident with the adrenaline? I've won pots every other way. Why not win a pot this way? Which is actually, some would say, the hardest way to win a pot in tournament hold'em.
Yeah, and this is a really interesting situation. Ben Vincent's checked the flop of King Queen Six. He probably thought there was a fair chance he was winning on this flop. He's thinking to himself, if Rory Brennan, you know, could have a king or a queen in his hand, but, you know, I've got a pair, that figures to be ahead quite often. You only hit the flop for roughly one in three times in hold'em, and he has hit the flop, he's made a pair. So he's checked the flop, probably just to keep the pot small and see what happens. And now he's decided to check raise. He's obviously representing a lot stronger hand than 7-6. And I guess Chris Dowling's probably going to have to fold.
Hey, look at that!
Well, that's a brilliant move from Chris Dowling. He basically had two choices there, as far as I was concerned. Throw your hand away, which I felt he would probably do about 9 times out of 10, or move all in. I'm delighted to see him move all in. It's shown absolute heart and commitment. He's there to win the game, and he said to himself, I can't stand this Ben Vincent keep making moves on me. I'm just going to pray he hasn't got a king and hope that if he's got a queen, he can throw it away. And Ben Vincent had to throw it away.
that was the old school Irish poker player in Chris Dowling. I mean, that was great, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And you said, you know, would Rory Brennan crack and maybe draw a line in the sand? That was Chris Dowling drawing his line.
And, I mean, like Maimonides, it's almost like... you know, Ben Vincent trying to say, I'm going to play the rest of this final table standing on one leg. I've done everything else. But really, he's got to go back to basics here, doesn't he? Do what works.
Yeah, I think Ben Vincent now, you know, it's a real horse race. Three of them have got roughly the same chips. Ben Vincent's got to say to himself, look, just steady yourself down, son. Don't get too carried away.
Back to plan A, raise from the button with most cards, Neil.
Yeah, I mean, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And this is the part of the game that Ben's managed mostly with. Having had a little bit of a wobble recently, it's going to be interesting to see what happens if one of the players decides to play back at Ben Vincent. Chris Dowling choosing not to there. I thought he might have done perhaps with the Queen 10. I wonder whether Rory Brennan's going to find something he fancies playing back with. I suspect it might not be hand-dependent. 10-7 is a sort of interesting hand to re-raise with. You've got a couple of live cards, and you've got flush and straight draws. I think he might decide to play back at Ben Vincent here.
And, I mean, in the metagame, best time to go for the juggler when a guy's wounded. Vincent having lost that last pot.
Absolutely. Actually, I'm not very keen on this play by Rory Brennan. What he's basically saying here is, I don't really believe you, Ben. I wouldn't mind seeing a flop because we both got big stacks and I can win a big pot. But I'm just going to flat call and play a pot out of position against the toughest of my two opponents. As it happens, it's come gin for him. He's a total luck box in this one because he's made top and bottom pair, and Ben Vincent's flop top pair, he's going to win an enormous pot, I would think.
How big a pot?
Well, Ben Vincent's come up with a brilliant check. I love the check there because what he's trying to do is sell weakness and try and get paid some money later in the hand. And what it's done is, on the turn, he's picked up a massive card. He's now got a flush draw to go with what was top pair on the flop. And I'm sure Ben's loving life, thinking he's winning at the moment, not realizing he's a 34% underdog in the hand.
But also a dangerous enough card that the pot is now not... It could have gotten really out of control on
the flop. Absolutely, absolutely, Jesse. And now I'm imagining, because Ben's picked up this draw, he's going to ask himself the question, do I go for the semi-bluff or do I assume that this guy's got nothing, which is always the best assumption in short-handed hold'em, and just call... So that he kind of, you know, this is what Ben's thinking, so that Rory bluffs again. He's not to know that Rory's got two pair. He's figuring that he's bluffing here. So if he raises, it's only to get rid of draws. He's decided calling's better. Let Rory bluff again. He figures Rory's bluffing, obviously. He doesn't know Rory's got two pair.
A lot of cards where Rory's not going to like the river. Is this one of them?
Oh, that really is one of them. Obviously, Ben's hit his hand now. He's made a flush. He very nearly made a straight flush. Not that he had a straight flush draw there. But, yeah, Ben's going to be probably liking things now. He's going to think that he's winning. Yeah, I don't know. Did Rory really make too many mistakes in this hand? I didn't really like the fact that he just called pre-flop. I thought he might have re-raised. Then he decided to check the flop. Quite reasonable. I mean, he's hit two pair. It's a massive hand, three-handed. And he's expecting an aggressive player like Ben Vincent to bet behind. The reason that Ben Vincent won this pot was because he checked the flop. I said at the time I thought it was a great check. He did it so that he can induce bluffs from Rory Brennan later in the hand. And what it actually did was give him a chance to win the pot. It was the only way he could win it.
It was a lovely check. You said he did get lucky. Turn river. It was definitely the way you would have played that. It felt like a real Neil Channing check there.
I'm proud of him. I don't know whether he's been watching me or I can definitely learn a lot from him, but I don't know. He definitely played it the way I would have played it. And I mean, first of all, the one reason he checked the flop was for pot control. He doesn't want the pot to spiral out of control against the tougher of his two opponents as he would probably view it. And also, he wants to give Rory the most chances to bluff him. And if he sells the idea he hasn't really got anything when he hits the flop, that gives Rory a chance to bluff him. That's why he checked the flop, and that's what won him the pot.
What do you imagine Rory's mindset is right now? For you, am I imagining things? Is he looking worried now?
Well, I don't think he's loving life in quite the way he probably was five-handed when he had sort of half the chips in play, five or six-handed. But if he really thinks about it, he's three-handed. The worst money that he's going to get now out of this thing is €55,000. He's a lot closer to the winning line than he was before, even though he hasn't got a dominant chip position. And, he's a good poker player. He's been in tournament situations plenty of times before, plays online most nights, playing tournaments over and over again. He's seen a lot of these situations. I wouldn't write him off yet.
Is he going to find a good situation? I mean, will Ben put chips in a spot? Well, this is a pretty good situation here.
Well, I think your question is basically, will Ben mess up against him or do something stupid or rash? I don't tend to think either of these two players, Ben and Rory, are going to do anything stupid or rash against each other. Certainly not at this stage. With the blinds relatively low. Maybe as we go through the tournament and the pressure of the blinds starts to build, that's when mistakes get made. At the moment, I think they're playing flary poker. There's plenty of adventure in their game. They play interesting ways. Ben's thinking here, have I got enough to re-raise all in and get him off the hand? And they're asking each other questions with their chips, but no one's doing anything really rash.
Is it raise all in to get him off the hand, or was there a re-raise there that would...
Ben asked the question, how much is it to me? He's thinking to himself, is there an argument for calling, perhaps? Can I just try and call and see if I can play a big pot with him?
And Ben has called here. His cards are live. He is in position.
And those are the two factors, really, Jesse. And obviously, he's totally outflopped poor Rory here. Rory's going to think to himself, well, there can't be too many hands he'd have called me with that contain a deuce, a three, or a five. So I'm probably winning with my ace high. And I think Rory's going to make a continuation bet here and try and just take the pot. And Ben, having flopped top pair, if you call raises with king and a five in your hand and the top card on the flop is a five, you're entitled to think you're winning. This could easily be a large pot.
110. That's about 110. Two-thirds the pot.
Yeah, and if Ben's going to make an effective re-raise and protect his king five, he's going to have to make a decent size raise. He's going to be calling 110. There's going to be now 380 in there. He's going to have to raise about 300 more. He's going to have to put 400 in. Perhaps that's the reason he's only called. Just see what comes off on the turn. Don't make the pot run out of control. Ben does a lot of that, and I don't mind it. Although here, maybe his hand's a bit vulnerable and he might have wanted to protect it.
Yeah, that is pretty vulnerable. The ace now making a straight.
Yeah, I mean, it's not a very deceptive straight, though. Ben's been raised pre-flop. The guy's led out on the flop. Rory's come out with a bet. Ben's going to think that an ace is well within his range. I should imagine at the moment he fancies puking on the table, Ben.
Just past 386,000, even though Rory's got the straight. With the live idea that Ben, he knows Ben thinks he could have an ace here, and a six completes a higher straight, do you favor a small bet, a big bet, or a check?
No, I think a check is the best bet here. He's got to try and sell the idea that he doesn't have an ace either and give Ben a chance to bet. If he bets, what's he going to get called by? He's gone for a 200,000 bet into 386. Ben's got to fear this straight. I think he's just going to throw his hand away, basically. But if Rory had a check there, at least he's giving Ben a chance to bluff. As we know, seeing the hands, Ben would have probably checked behind him. But there might have been chances for Rory to get more chips on the river.
Is there an idea that obviously very likely for Rory to have an ace, but very unlikely for him to have a six?
All in.
Cool.
All in.
And Ben's moved all in. Well, there's no way I can see that Rory can pass this hand. He took a deep breath as if to say, I really don't like this, but I don't think I can pass. I think that's what that deep breath said.
And he made that 200,000, yeah, he made that 200,000 bet knowing that he might be inducing a bluff and he was gonna have to back it up, right?
Yeah, I mean, we said at the start of this pot that the blinds weren't big enough and the chip stacks were too deep for either of these experienced players to make an unforced error. But I'm afraid Ben Vincent's made a very big one there. And Rory Brennan is certainly the beneficiary of a bit of a Christmas present there.
You take all the small ones, I'll take the big one with a stamp of my fist. And Rory Brennan is gonna have a massive amount of chips, 1.6 million. What was the key there? What was the key there? He is now massive chip leader. Ben's got 238.
Just give me the odd one.
Well, that's just the hand Rory had been waiting on in that spot. Ben picked the wrong time to try to make a move, in my opinion. Open in straight on the board to move in on a guy there. Very dangerous, and it cost him dearly.
He caught him speeding. Was that Rory's plan all along? I mean, how much trouble is Ben Vincent in now? And is Rory back on your big favorite for you here?
Well, Ben started out this final table marching with two left feet, I thought. There he tripped over himself, but who knows? We've seen him come back and pile up a lot of chips very quickly. Let's see if he can do it again.
By the time Rory Brennan manages to stack those chips up, the tournament could be over.
Well, Ben Vincent's announced a quick all-in here.
And a call.
And a quick call. Well, it must be something pretty big, would you say?
Yeah, it was blind on blinds. So obviously, Ben is looking to get his chips in first. He knows that Chris Dowling's maybe the more conservative of the two, might be easiest to steal against. He's done it with 7-8. Chris Dowling's found a big hand in king-queen suited, and he's hit a massive flop. He's
not just a massive flop, but he must be drawing nearly dead here.
Well, he hasn't hit... I think the percentages went up from the pre-flop there on the camera, but... Yeah, unfortunately, Ben Vincent there just walking into one. And obviously, it was really the other hand that knocked him out. I thought Ben played absolutely brilliantly in the final for 99% of the time.
Well, obviously, a bit disappointed that obviously, once you get that far, you want to win it, but still, I'm happy with the payday, and it's a good result to start the year.
Well, we're Irish on Irish now for the final two, Mike. I mean, how do you handicap this matchup?
Well, you've got an amateur player, an electrician from Kildare versus a pro out of Dublin. And the pro out of Dublin has the big chip lead. You gotta make him the nice favorite here. Well, one thing's for sure, the championship trophy is once again gonna stay in Ireland for the Party Poker Irish Poker Championship. We're down to heads up play now. It's come down to an amateur out of Kildare, Chris Dowley. We'll start with him. Chris, a lot of top European pros played in this event. How did you really fancy your chances as this tournament began? Did you really think you could get to the final table and play heads up for this title?
Well, I hoped I could get to the final table, I'll put it like that. I think in tournaments, the amateurs have a bit better crack at it because you never know what's going to happen.
Well, you've certainly played like a pro this week. There's no question about it. You've done very well. You got a great shot. Your opponent's starting out with a 700,000 chip lead, but still, as we know, in heads up play, anything can happen. Now let's talk to our chip leader, Rory Brennan. out of Dublin, 23 years old. You came to this final table as the big chip leader. Here you are, the chip leader, playing heads up for this title. Couldn't have gone much better for you so far.
Yeah, we had a few bumps along the way, but we got here eventually, and just going to give it my best shot now. Yeah.
Well, there you have it. Both these players vying for the Party Poker Irish Poker Championship. One of them's going to take home the big bucks and the special trophy that goes with it.
You cannot put it any more eloquently than Mike Sexton did. The money, Neil, will come and go, but when your grandkids are sitting on your knee, only one of these two players can look up to that fireplace and point to that trophy on the mantle.
Absolutely, Jesse. That's what it's all about.
And Rory Brennan, nearly twice as many chips as Chris Dowling. And a little bit, probably have a lot of experience in this sort of heads up, no limit. Is it a small pot and chip away? Is that his strategy?
Yeah, I guess that'll be Rory Brennan's strategy. I mean, people often talk about these online young hotshot internet players playing thousands and thousands of hands online. And a lot of the time, I think they're playing 10 tables at once. They're folding most of the hands. But it's these short-handed situations that they're really getting to see. And this is where experience counts for a lot. It's also nice if you have a pair of eights quite often.
There's been chips changed up, and
50 more.
I believe there's these new blue chips in play, which are worth 10,000 apiece. Of course, the pink 500 chips have gone. The raise from the big blind to the limp up to 50,000, and you know, Dowling can call with any wide variety hands. He's got position, and of course, he knows that just because Rory raised doesn't mean he has a premium hand. In this case, actually, it does, but...
Yeah, but of course, this is not a great flop for a pair of eights, is it, Jesse?
And we're gonna get a little indication about both players from this
95.
Sequence on 95. The flop. Is it as obvious as continuation bet fold, or...?
Well, I mean, Rory has to bet, really. He figures that he didn't get re-raised by Chris Dowling, so that means Chris can't have a big ace in his hand. And so he has to have one stab at it and then review on the turn. As it happens, Chris missed completely. He's facing someone that raised pre-flop. The flop's got an ace and a king on it. He's going to make a perfectly natural pass. He's not to know that that Rory only had a pair of eights.
He has looked cool, not sweating a bit, but pulse rate might get a little higher. Rory has shown great composure, but you know what? This Chris Dowling, here's a guy. I mean, and it would be an electrician, wouldn't it? I mean, you know, when you walk into a fuse box with 8 million volts, if you tend to panic, you're quickly going to get yourself in trouble.
Yeah, I think if Chris Dowling wins this one, there's plenty of opportunities for puns in the press release.
Both got the same hand here, Neil.
Yeah, and obviously we were saying before, an ace heads up is an enormous hand. Chris Dowling has raised with his ace. Rory Brennan's looking at it. On the one hand, he's decided to himself, I want to play small poker against this guy. I'm going to grind him down over a long period. On the other hand, he's going, I've got an ace. I'm bound to be winning. Maybe I should just re-raise and steal this pot back.
Raise.
200.
What he doesn't want to see is a re-raise. Is Chris capable? Is there any argument for it at all?
Well, there's always an argument for sticking all your chips in. I tend to find that argument I gets the better of me quite quickly. Chris has done it here. He's shown before that he's not afraid to do it. This is a brave move by him. I don't think Rory Brennan can call.
Not only is it a brave move, but recognition from Chris that this is his angle to...
I think you're right, Jesse. I mean, on the one hand, we're saying that Chris Brennan needs to play small pot poker, grind away, use his experience. On the other hand, Chris Dowling needs to say, do you know what? My best bet is just to be brave, stick the whole lot in, make Rory make tough decisions.
And to be aware of that fact, to have that strategy, you know, in this high-pressure situation, I mean, that's great stuff. The ace four, I mean, basically he was bluffing there.
I think he certainly thought he was bluffing. These players are not hooked up to heart rate monitors, but I'd like to bet that Chris's went through the roof there.
if Rory Brennan was to pick up, say, a big hand on the button, I'm talking like ace, king, or a big pair, is that limpable? Or does he want to play a little bit straight with that sort of hand?
While the blinds are relatively small to the chip stacks, I think he's not going to want to get into a situation where he has a big hand and he goes broke with it after getting very little of his money in pre-flop while he's winning. So actually, it's quite a tricky spot now for Rory if he does pick up a really big hand early on.
And this probably is kind of nice stuff here from Dowling, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. I think Rory's probably happier, though, just kind of grafting away, winning these small ones at the moment. That'll suit him better.
Top pair for Chris, bottom pair for Rory. If he makes a continuation bet here, it feels dangerous. What is he? If he bets here, what is the intention of the bet?
80.
Well, it's a little bit of a bet to find out where you are. He thinks he's probably winning. It doesn't look as if Chris Dowling's got anything much here. He hasn't shown a lot of inclination to win this pot. And I guess when he makes the bet, he's thinking to himself, I'm probably winning. I might as well have a crack at it. If he has got a seven, he might believe me for an ace. You know, that kind of thing. Chris Dowling's played the hand nicely. He's done the thing that's natural in this situation. You play your hand deceptively pre-flop. You flop a big hand. You're inclined to check it, and that's what he did.
He opted not to check raise on the flop there, Dowling, and Brennan's now hit second pair. How dangerous now is this?
Yeah, this is really dangerous now for Chris Dowling. I actually like his play in the pot. You know, he sold deception on every street, check called the flop. He's just really unlucky that Rory Brennan's made two pair on the turn. But it is a very tricky to see two pair. He may believe that Rory Brennan has an ace at some stage in this pot and may be able to get off of it for all his chips, but he's definitely going to lose some money here.
It's also possible he check called the flop 150. Intending to check raise the turn, isn't it? Or is ace three not big enough for that?
It's definitely possible, Jesse. It's interesting here that Rory Brennan's betting out. This is a kind of a similar situation to the hand against Ben Vincent.
All in.
Cool.
And there you go. The same kind of thing happened. He led out for a weakish bet on the turn, and it caused Chris Dowling to move all his chips in, and Chris Dowling is now facing elimination from the tournament in second place.
He didn't just call quickly. He insta-called, and that's seven on the river. Dowling's hit it. He's not gone. Does he realize he just went ahead?
Oh, my word, Jesse. He's been counterfeited on the river. That is to say, a second pair has come along. Chris Dowling has made aces and sevens with a king kicker. This is desperately unlucky for poor old Rory.
Well, there's going to be a big role reversal here now with Chris having about twice as many as Rory. I mean, how much the dynamics change? Can Rory Brennan, he's been so calm and cool, can he come back from this?
Yeah. Well, make no mistake, Jesse, Rory Brennan can definitely come back from this. The blinds are still relatively small to the chip stacks. He's still got plenty of chips. Obviously, he went into the heads up a big chip leader, and the positions have completely reversed. You know, the blinds are now 15,000, 30,000, and there's a little bit of anti-money as well, and Rory can add quite a large proportion to his stack just by stealing the blinds now.
So you can safely say he has gone to plan B here.
Well, it looks like he might have done, although as it was on that hand, he had a pretty decent hand in King Jack, which heads up, you know, is quite a strong hand. And again there, he's folding the button with a weak hand. That's indicative of the fact that he is saving chips to make big all-in moves.
It's also, I mean, it's not just us who have noticed it, but now Dowling, who has noticed, obviously, that Brennan has folded a couple hands here from the button. He wasn't doing that earlier. He is trying to send a message to Chris here now. Look, if I raise from the button, don't re-raise me lightly. Give it up, man.
Well, it's interesting because oftentimes patterns develop when you're playing heads up. And you try and sort of send the guy the message, right, I'm slowing down now. I'm only going to play big hands for a while. I'm only raising the button when I've got a proper hand to raise with. And if you send that message out, the other guy might often pick up on it and a pattern will develop where if you limp the button, I'll limp the button.
This is a perfect example of a hand that Chris Dowling might be prepared to re-raise all in with, right?
Well, this might be an example of a hand where Chris Dowling doesn't want to really raise the button with pair of threes because he feels that that quite often in these situations, Rory Brennan's moving all in. But this is an enormous flop for both hands here.
And well, it looks like Brennan's going to lead here. What do you think Dowling should do? What will he do here?
Well, so far when Chris Dowling's had a big pot heads up, like, for example, when he had the aces, when Rory Brennan had ace-queen, he slow played on every street. I would imagine it'll be too tempting. A set heads up is such a massive hand. I would imagine that if Rory Brennan bets about 45,000 here, then Chris Dowling will probably just flat call him.
That might actually even slow down the action, huh? It's funny, the Scandinavian sort of move is like the check raise all in with the flush draw. Brennan's let out here.
Yeah, people used to always check raise all in with the flush draw. It's more common for people to lead out now. They think that it disguises their hand more. He went for a bet of about, I think he went for a bet of 40,000. So now Chris Dowling's not going to win too much if he raises here. He's gone for the call as we thought he might.
Caressing the chips, and you know, if Brennan hits his flush, he can really get all those money in.
Wow, Jesse, he's hit the flush. Now, Chris Dowling has to know this is heads up. It's not guaranteed. Just because a flush has come, it doesn't mean to say the other guy's hit a flush. Chris Dowling has to lose some money here unless the board pairs.
Brennan has done well with these weak leads on the turn. He must know that the pattern is that, you know, even if Dowling just had like a hand like a big nine or something like that, that a lead here might get an all in.
I think you've hit the nail on the head, Jesse. I think he's going to bet about 75 to 85. Oh, he's gone for a check.
It's gone check, check.
Wow. And the ace on the river. I mean, this looks now like another kind of card that Rory Brennan might have hit. If you're sitting there and you're Chris Dowling, I think you still definitely think you're winning this pot.
Has Brennan...
Surely Rory Brennan must bet now. Chris Dowling showed no inclination to steal the pot, so he can't think that by checking that Chris is going to make an attempted steal, he must put a value bet in. Something like about 80,000, I'd guess.
And, I mean, is there a chance that Dowling might raise him here?
Well, I think because Dowling didn't bet the turn, he's not really going to think about bluffing on the river. Having decided not to bet the turn, it must be because he was a little worried about the flush, and he's just going to pay off.
Surely, three of a kind, heads up, Neil, and the chance that he could end the tournament right here.
All in.
Well, he's moved all in, Jesse. That's unbelievable.
Cool. And Rory has to go, if you got a bigger flush than me, show me, he says.
Yeah, he's moved all in there. And basically, when he moves all in, he has to ask himself, what hands is Rory Brennan going to call me with that I'm beating? And the only hands he's really going to call him with that he's beating is two pair. And it's very hard to really put Rory Brennan on two pair in that hand. I think that's a bad all in there.
These guys are both sitting down, but Rory Brennan must feel like standing up, jumping up, doing a lap around the table. He's just doubled up, and he may feel like this tournament is his again. Mike's down there. Mike, that hand went really funny on the turn, didn't it?
Well, it really did. On the flop and the turn, in my view, and on the river, an unusually played hand.
More in the ammunition department for Brennan than before. But no indication, really, that this tournament is anywhere close to wrapping. We've seen two all-ins. Cards on their back since his head-up began. Both of them went to the shorter stack.
80,000.
And what is this? What's this about?
Well, this is just a standard raise from the button, Jesse. He's got two suited cards. He's got, he doesn't have a lot of high card strength, 9-5. Obviously, it's not the greatest no limit hold'em hand in a full table, but we're playing heads up now, and the chances are the other guy doesn't have anything. And when you have the button, it's generally best to raise. 80,000 standard raise. Chris Dowling here, he's got an ace in his hand, and he's chosen to just call.
This is a bit reminiscent of the ace three hand much earlier, very early on.
Yeah, I wonder what's going on at the moment in Chris Dowling's mind during this hand. It may be that he's saying to himself, I'm happy playing this small pot poker, it's going okay for me. He may be saying to himself, I don't want to play an enormous pot with a weak kicker with my ace. I'm not really sure. I think he may feel he's setting up a trap for later. As it is, Rory Brennan's flop to flush draw and a pair. Another great flop for him.
Big flop for Brennan. In fact, if he's asked a question about getting all the money in on the flop, he's going to have to answer in the affirmative, right?
Well, the other thing that could happen here is if a heart comes on the turn, then Chris Dowling's going to have a massive hand. So I've got a feeling Chris might call here. He's got a gut shot and an overcard ace here. And a lot of times this figures to be a strong hand. It's called pre-flop. He must have had a planned pre-flop when he just called. I can see him just calling here.
Because of the way Dowling played that sort of top pair earlier, Brennan has every reason to believe that Dowling actually has a king here. I mean, doesn't he?
Oh, Jesse. Well, this is a massive card, actually. I mean, obviously, Rory Brennan's made a flush. It's very hard to make a flush in Hold'em. It's even harder when your head's up. But Chris Dowling must be thinking Christmas has come. He's made a pair. He's got the nut flush draw. He's got a straight draw. He's got an overcard. I mean, normally, this would be an enormous hand heads up. Chris Dowling's bet 120,000, and it's down to Rory Brennan. He's certain he's winning at this stage. He just needs to decide how he's going to extract the maximum out of this hand. I also reckon, Jesse, that the longer that Rory Brennan thinks about this, the more likely it is that he's just trying to...
All in.
Oh, wow, he's made a big decision to go all in here, and...
Cool.
Wow.
He thought about it. I don't know what the reasons were exactly there, Neil, the final argument, but he has got on 84% chance.
Wow, this is an incredible hand now. I mean, this has turned into an enormous pot, Jesse.
And Dowling actually has outs for the tournament. If it comes a heart, Neil, Chris Dowling's the champion.
Absolutely, Jesse.
The black card, and all of a sudden now, Rory Brennan, I think the strongest spot he's been in throughout this tournament.
Well, he's now got almost 1.9 million chips. He's an enormous chip leader, and well, it's going to be almost impossible for Chris Dowling to come back from this situation, I would think.
All the chips start to look the same after a while. I mean, Rory Brennan must be kind of looking down and thinking, how many have I got? What day is it? When will this guy go away? Because Chris Dowling,
85.
He just seems to keep coming back at you, doesn't he?
Mm. This one will be interesting. I think that it'll be a quick pot. It's a raise on the button by Chris Dowling. Ace 10 is a massive hand heads up, and I think Rory Brennan will just go for the re-raise. It's not quite a big enough hand to want to slow play it out of position. It's probably better just to re-raise and pick up the chips that are there and grind a bit more out of Chris Dowling.
Does Dowling actually have too many chips for the big re-raise? I mean, where if Brennan puts his stack in, he's only going to get called if he's in
Well, he doesn't really need to make it too big, Jesse. If he goes for a re-raise of a couple of 100,000, it's implied that the rest of the money's going in anyway.
Re-raise.
He set it soft.
He's going to make it 170,000.
Is this 170,000 with the rest sure to follow? Maybe to follow?
I
meant
think it's
to follow?
Maybe to follow.
Much? 230
in total, Jesse. So he's raised an extra 150,000.
130,000.
Just from what we've seen of Dowling, you wouldn't be sure which way he wants to go. Is he in a mood to gamble?
No, this is an easy fold for him. He made his move to win the pot. He's going to move on to the next hand.
Yeah,
oh, wow. We got it wrong there, Jessica. I'm sorry about that. I got that one really wrong. Well,
he's got backbone, Dowling, but he's also been called here, Neil.
Yeah, I think he was always going to get called there. It was just bad timing there by Chris Dowling. Having said that, he's still a 34% chance to win the pot, so...
Oh, the nine was in the window, but the ace peeking through the other side.
Well, that was a real heart-in-mouth moment there for Chris Dowling. He got to see the nine first, thought he'd hit the front, and then he saw the ace squeak through.
And that seven really hurts, because now it has to be a nine on the river. It's not.
Well, Jesse, that seven on the turn was a horrible card. Chris Dowling could see it slipping away, and he put up a brave fight, heads up, but it always looked to be Rory Brennan's to win.
Chris Dowling has played a brave game, but Rory Brennan, the Irish poker champion, Mike, now the smile comes out. Rory's showing a lot of emotion there, and he deserves it, doesn't he?
No chips across the other side.
And now let's talk to our champion from Dublin. Rory, congratulations.
Thanks,
Perfect
man, Mike.
Show you put on. You came to this final table as the big chip leader.
Yeah.
You played great all week. You know, we thought you had great composure, great temperament throughout this tournament, especially when you got down at this final table. I mean, you had a big flip-flop in chip lead, yet you managed to fight back and win. Those are traits of a champion. Congratulations on your performance. How are you feeling right now?
I just feel unbelievably happy. I mean, I thought I was down and out after that the hand I lost heads up, and I had almost given in, but I just feel unbelievable right now, top of the world.
And for your efforts, besides 160,000 euros you're going to collect, let me present you this beautiful championship trophy. Congratulations, Rory. Rory Brennan, the Party Poker Irish Poker Champion.
That's it from us here at the Radisson Hotel in Galway, the end of the Party Poker Irish Poker Championship. Rory Brennan from Dublin crowned our champion. Hope you've enjoyed the series and we'll see you soon. Bye-bye.
Well, I'm delighted with the money, obviously. It's a massive amount of money for me to win. Disappointed with my play heads up. In general, I'm delighted. Things are going well. Well, the phone hasn't stopped ringing with all the mates and people I play poker with congratulating me and this, that and the other. And there's a lot more of my friends back playing now because a lot of them think they're a better player than I am. So if I can win something like that or win that amount of money, they think they're going to do it as well.
Couldn't beat the feeling. Just especially that I had to work so hard for it heads up, and it was up and down, back and forth, just to get through it in the end and come out as the winner. Just unbelievable feeling, so happy. Like a lot of poker players are dying to win a World Series bracelet and at least make a World Series final table, hopefully this year. Hopefully just keep the cashes coming and keep going the way I am.